What's up, guys? Welcome back to Wind Chaser. I'm gonna start off my tractor here. We're currently in field 14, which will be soybeans. I'm just on my spreadsheet here. looking at, and then we'll go over to sunflower and sunflower, then soybean, 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 soybean. We have 520 acres of soybean, 407 of sunflower. Alright, then we got seed cost. Burning up a lot of seed in sunflower. Alright, anyways. Get back to some planting. As you can see, I have a damage mod installed. I actually did a conversion like a week or two ago because I was curious, and then found out that it was also just came out today by Mar, you know, the guy that always does the scripting and such. So I might transfer that script over because I'm sure he probably did a better job than me. But as far as I know, mine works well, and I don't have any issues with that. I tested out on the other video when I was driving around in the CT660, so everything seemed to be fine except a little bit exaggerated, so that's about the only thing I can think of that might have been changed. So. So I'm not using Follow Me mod in this field. It's just too small for Follow Me, and I'll probably use it for 23 and 20, you know, the rest of the fields. But this is just such a small field that it doesn't really justify the hassle of running two machines by myself, plus running the risk of having my Follow Me driver run into me, causing some damage, because damage is not cheap. If you're watching that video of where I kind of like drove around the map, acting crazy, testing out how dramatic it was, we pretty much totaled our CT660. It was like 28,000, so I'd probably be close to like $32,000 in damages if we were to like completely total the vehicle. So, but even if you do like 10% damage or so, you know, that's a good chunk of money, you know, $4,000 or $5,000 that you have to pay for. Otherwise, it starts affecting your vehicle performance, I believe. I'm not sure if it affects your trade-in value, which it really should. Our planter seems to be taking down some grass here. I updated to the new soil mod, so I'm noticing some changes with the planter here. It's kind of reducing the grass. So I drove the other planter down here and I parked it in 23 where I'll start planting after I finish this field, which really won't take very long. I kind of have a a cold going on. Just been some really long days, no sleep, just my immune system's totally shot. And here I am filming farm sim videos. Try to load up GPS here. It's gonna be nice when we trade in this and get a new Challenger. Anyways, we opened up 23 quite a bit, and we also opened up field 25. Should really do another headland down here. But what can you do? I should really do another headlamp because this is too difficult. So my planter, the planter itself is wider than it is long due to the Bauer built sleeve frame, which really is amazing, because you look at other planters like White or Crossbuster and they don't have that feature. And so your planter is as long as it is wide, instead of, you know, a fraction, you know, it's, you know, two thirds as long as it is wide, or half as long as it is wide. So I guess really cumbersome to, I would imagine it would be cumbersome to turn and stuff like that. And I was kind of looking at building a Crossbuster planter our grains like oat, wheat, barley, and canola and stuff like that, with a center fill bunker. They make like a 60 foot cedar, but the actual cedar itself doesn't have a sleeve frame. So I mean, it's like the same working width as this, but it has, you know, probably 3 or 4 times as many row units, whatever the spacing is on those to drill in wheat and stuff like that. But it looks really cool, other than the fact that it's not a oh, there's a train. That's one thing I added, is I made the train spines come way down here now. Because I built the tracks, and it's just kind of annoying seeing it going back and forth. down there by the modern bee farm, so. Tell that we're planting over plowed ground. I'm not too happy about it. I don't want to be doing it. I'd rather do some kind of seedbed prep, but as it is now, there's really no benefit to running over this ground with the cultivator because it gives no benefit to the planter, or I should say planting over plowed terrain is no, there's no negative effect on the planter from doing so. The only thing going over the cultivator would do is burn up more of our soil moisture. And if you guys have been farming with soil mod for any period of time, you'll know that sometimes it's really difficult to maintain your soil moisture. So that's kind of why I'm hesitant to go back over and kind of do a finishing of our fields that we chisel plow. Also, if you're following my Instagram or Facebook, you would know that I have started and almost nearly complete the modeling of a new 2730 combination disc ripper, which I was really reluctant to build because it's by far probably the most difficult model, really, that I would have built. It's so complex. You know, you might not think of it, but when you actually start studying the diagrams, the exploded view diagrams, and you look at the angles that some of these things are, I mean, I swear to God that combination disc ripper doesn't have a single 90 degree rectangle piece on it. It's all kind of this crazy curvature, different angles. You know, such odd angles, 23 degrees, 25 degrees, you know, 45 degrees off center, so it's really difficult to model as compared to something like even, for example, this thing is just a bunch of rectangles and some chamfers, you know, and it's at 90 degrees. I could build this at 90 degrees except for these kind of drawbar bars, but I mean, It's incredibly easy to build implements that are kind of square framed, you know, just rectangles inside rectangles, and then maybe like a few triangles with like dividers. But this thing is so bizarre to make, and there's so many components that are built at those bizarre angles. I mean, the main disc frames are at 25 degrees. And then you gotta build the disc mounts, that, you know, everything to it. And so it's a little bit challenging because I build, Blender is not the greatest thing when you're building at odd angles. You can change your geometry origin to like build off a normal, but if you're using global coordinates, it's definitely difficult. So what I do is I kind of like build a piece, kind of like position it where I want to see if my length and width and height are all good. Then I'll flip it back, so I'm building in a, you know, a true X, Y, Z plane, nothing in between. But it just it adds to the time to build because it's always you're always testing what you made, and it's always too big or too short, or it doesn't, you know, line up. And then when you're making minor adjustments to scale, you know, in and out, it's truly a pain because the way Blender works, it's not the most intuitive modeling program. Where if you're used to like something like a SolidWorks, it really likes building off of planes. You know, you can go directly 90 degrees off of a plane. Where Blender, it uses a normal kind of coordinate system, and it's not always 90 degrees off the face if you have multiple vertices selected. So that's why it's not the greatest modeling software. It's good, if you know how to use it, but it has severe limitations as compared to other more professional modeling software. So that's kind of why I was reluctant to build it, because it was kind of like the Oxbow merger. It's, you're building off these 37 and 34 degree, you know, angled faces, and it's Blender literally like throws a fit when you try to elongate or shrink and stuff like that when you're working at those odd faces that are at that weird angle. Anyways, the hard part's over. It's pretty much done. All I have left to do is put in some cylinders, a couple cylinder mounts, and then it's ready for UV mapping and burning. Of course, I had to add decals and stuff like that, but that's kind of the last thing I do. But yeah, that's going to come in really handy. It's spec'd at a little over 26 feet, actually. It's about, instead of 7.9 point whatever meters, it's, I just rounded up to 8 meters. So it's 8 meters working with on the nose, which I think is fairly reasonable. It's not that big of a fudge factor when you're only going up a tenth of a point, a tenth of a meter. Which a tenth of a meter is 100 centimeters, which is basically less than 5 inches, 2.54 centimeters an inch. So, whatever, I'll live with it. So I didn't refill this planner when we finished up 13. So I'm running on fumes from that, just because it still had, we put beams in 13 and this was 13, and 23 and 24, these next big fields will be sunflower, and then everything else is soybeans. So that's why I skipped over this field, just because I didn't want to swap out seed. And I don't really like how I can change seed without going to a tender. Like the fertilizer with the soil mod, you have to go, you can like set it now in the V2 to like do kind of a global fill change, but I like it where you have to actually go up to a trigger of a tender, and like a fertilizer trigger, and have to swap out there. A little bit more realistic. Sometimes it's a pain in the ass, but you know, what can you do? Ask me if I like New Holland, and it's because like, we were using a New Holland combine and stuff like that, and it's not that I like New Holland or dislike New Holland or infatuated with New Holland or anything like that. It's just that I spend so many hours using John Deere tractors and John Deere combines, and then I spend so many hours in 13 using Case equipment, that finally there's actual nice quality New Holland models, so I'm taking advantage of it and trying to get my fix. I mean, the next nicest model would be Julian's T9 that he built in 13, and Raphael did some nice work on the fenders, you know, quick little thing in the wheels, and I did the rest of the work, so I'm enjoying using my little T9s. Especially the 450s, spent a lot of time running this 450, broadcasting manure and stuff like that when I was doing beef and dairy. But now it's a little small. I finished up my 775E. Surprisingly, I thought that was going to take forever to get done. You know, one of those things that you just kind of like hesitant to do because you realize how much work it is, but then you kind of like you just kind of like bite the bullet and start it, and then once you start, it's kind of addicting, and you don't really realize how much time you're spending on things, and it's going together quick, and you're having a lot of fun, and you're learning the whole model and design as you're studying images. It goes by quick, and then when you like take your head up and you get off your chair and you look at what you have accomplished, and it's amazing how when you're really motivated to do something, how quickly you're able to do it. So, and that's another thing. I've been getting a lot of messages and requests, along the lines of, can you make this? You should model this. Can you make this? And the answer is, of course I can, but am I going to? No. Because it requires a tremendous amount of energy and motivation to take a model from a fucking cube to in-game error-free usability. We're talking 40, 60, upwards of 300 hours for some of these things. So it requires extreme amount of focus and motivation. Because I have so many projects in my, Blender files that, I just lost interest. I mean, look at the Rogator, the RG1300. I mean, I just kind of lost interest, and then I kind of lost interest in making a 700 series Challenger, and then I made it, kind of lost interest in making a big John Deere disc, and then I eventually made it. I lost interest in making a new chisel plow until I used my 2720 for a year and I'm sick of it. It's just kind of have to build up the courage to just pull the trigger and spend a couple hours at an evening and just kind of really put a big dent into it, so it's less intimidating. Same thing with going with maps. It's like you look at the map and you're like, oh my god, there's so much. I have to do this, that, this other thing. And you realize how much work is left and you just don't want to do it. But you realize that if you don't do it, no one's going to do it, and so whatever. You do it, and you... The nice thing, though, is kind of why I'm going with John Deere on a lot of my implements, is because a lot of the components are used and reused in a lot of different John Deere pieces of equipment, like hitches, wheels, walking wheel assemblies, fuel tanks, row units, shanks, crump, all that stuff is kind of reused over and over again. And so once you build something, it's like, great, I can use this on like, three or four additional models. So that's kind of how I justify modeling a few things, is I can, it's not like a one and done. It's not, custom made for this one model that I'll never be able to use it again. But in some cases it is. Some cases there's very few things that you can reuse, because some of these pieces of equipment are so specialized in what they do and frame design. And, a 2720 and a 2723 are so drastically different. It's like a 2720 almost has more in common with their vertical tillage than anything. And then, even the 2623 I built, it's like so specialized in the frame and everything like that. And even the caster, the walker wheels up front, very different than the ones I built for 2720. Challengers. Nice thing about the Challengers, I can reuse most of it from my 800. I just had to kind of tweak the ladder a little bit, tweak the mainframe a little bit, tweak the track undercarriage just a tad. and then I built a new cabin which I can use on my 800 again. I obviously built a new hood which I can modify again for an 800 model. It's just kind of when you like build these things, you try to build it so you don't have to keep building every single component from scratch, you know. And I have to say the least enjoyable thing I make are cylinders, hydraulic cylinders, because they're such a pain to, I mean, they're extremely easy to make. It requires no effort to make a cylinder, but where the effort comes in is, when you make it, you have to, align everything, and then when you export to GE, you have to align everything pointing flat and forward at 90 degrees, and you have to do all these centers of origin. So I would say modeling the cylinder, the damn hydraulic cylinder, is my least favorite thing to model, position, and script, because it's the most tedious, time-consuming, and it never looks as good as it does when you first build it. Anyways, this is our seed tender. We got about a whole planter's worth. Ooh, wrong button. I have, you can hear the difference in the sounds. Added indoor sounds to this. A little bit quiet. I have to do it on my T9s as well. Just because those, they get a little loud and it hurts my ears. And it's just nice to be in a little bit quieter cab, like you'd expect in real life. So we're just gonna run down here and top off our one planter and change to sunflower seeds. It's nice to see we have no damage on any of our vehicles yet. So, I don't know if you guys have seen the videos of this yet, but I'll just move my... automatically unloads. You can kind of see particle animation. Need to fix the fill volume on this thing because it's a little crazy. So this truck, I think, is close to empty. So I wanted a little bit larger seed tender for our planters. This is a, I think it's a 34 foot, I built it, 34 foot gooseneck, and a 650 bushel box, which comes out to just under 24,000 liters of seed, and it handles quite a bit better. Has a lot of mouse control functions. Fill plan, I need to remake that. Kind of bugs me. Might just make like a fill plane like 13 that's kind of animated and timed. Has a folding ladder on it. Has a swiveling auger. Put it out like this. So pretty happy with how it turned out. It was a really quick build. It was like a one or two, it was like a two day build. So it was like a speed building. But it's pretty cool little tank to make. It's not the nicest looking. I'd rather the JM, I think, is a nicer looking tender. But oh well. Meridian's cool. I kind of want to make a big semi-Meridian tender with conveyor for if I ever made a RG1300 with swappable dry box and sprayer. Back that up and auger would turn on, or the conveyor would turn on and fill up our Rogator with lime or whatever we're putting down. So the farm is looking pretty nice. We got new sheds, new scales, some nice new equipment. The 2720s will be gone eventually. In our shop, have our combines, our 1500 Kinsey, our 36 foot tandem dolly. This is the moment of truth. I'm gonna swing this out. I think we're kinda out of room here. And you can see that it's automatically filling up my tender. Right? There we go. Kind of a weird looking thing, but anyways, it works. I need to build something like Abel did. I gave him a version of my map, and he kind of had an outdoor seat thing where you just put the auger underneath, and it looks really cool. Anyways, that's filling up. make sure we're planting sunflower. Engage our follow me mod, burning up a lot of money in seed, which is fine. We have a great demand for soybean coming up. So this isn't the biggest field in the world, but me and Mike were running 327-20 is in this field, and it still took quite a while to get completely chisel plowed in. If we go back to this, you can actually see 23 is, I think that's actually a little bit low, because that was calculated before we expanded, I think. As I'd say, this is probably 37, 40 acres. I'd have to go back and verify. Anyways, hope you guys are enjoying the videos. Haven't kind of been slacking lately, I've been pretty busy. And I realize we're going pretty heavy with the planting videos, which, I mean, it's pretty rare, actually. I haven't put up a planting video in some time, I think. I think the last time I was doing planting videos was with my DB120 and all the John Deere stuff. Many months ago is when I was doing a lot of planting videos. Otherwise, it's been a lot of just harvest and tillage. Because usually we get planting done in a couple days because we use those big air seeders. Or we do it and we don't record, so. Yeah, at least we're getting a lot of tillage videos in, so. Load up a GPS while I'm down here. So this is actually a really nice field. I actually like it. I used to not like this field, but now that we kind of cleaned it up and spruced it up with trees down here, and it's a nice little kind of hidden away field back here, and doesn't get much attention. And that's kind of why we picked it up and we're planting here. Nice to finally get over here and actually work in this kind of rarely used corner, I guess. see people basically like getting excited about Cattle and Crop and how it's going to be a lot better than Farming Simulator. And the thing is, it's probably not, because as does this game, it's going to rely on modding. And if people aren't going to mod in Farming Simulator, or they're not going to release stuff, they're not going to do it in Cattle and Crops either. So, I don't really understand the logic in that. I mean, the only thing is, the game itself might actually be fundamentally a more sound, more in-depth actual simulator than the Giants. But other than that, if it's, you know, it's going to be able to, you're going to be able to mod in it. But unless they do something to protect the modder's work, I don't really see it being very different than what Farming Simulator is today. Actually, I think I might have saved this. Because this runs a different line than... I thought this was different. Anyways, we're probably going to do our two headland pass again. I really hate doing that, but I don't really see a way around it with Follow Me Mod because the turning is so barbaric. Make sure I don't hit my other planter. So we burnt up about 20% of our seed. Seed usage of sunflower is about 800 liters a hectare. That's what I have to spend that. Soybeans around 500 liters a hectare. Corn and Milo, I believe, are 270. I kind of dropped that down. I think it was like 300 or 400 or something. It was a little high. Burned it up a little bit too much. Corn seed population was too high compared to what it really should be, so dropped that down a tad. Corn on the map is spec'd at $4.50. Corn. So with great demands, we actually get a pretty decent price. You know, you're looking at $7 to probably $9 bushel corn on great demands. We do fairly well with corn, good yields, good price. Same with a lot of our other crops. try to only sell during great demands. And it's really not an issue, because we're able to truck in all of our grain within an hour, typically. This next season is going to be questionable. We're doing about projected 2.5 million liters of corn, and we can really only do about 1.8 million by ourselves. I think I figured it to be around, when I did the planning prescription for the server, we kind of did a dry run to Conagra. We did about 1.4 million easy with just two Wilsons. So we figured if we had a third truck going, we could easily do an additional, 700 or whatever it was, because we had time left over when we finished. We probably had 20 minutes or whatever when we sold all that grain, or like 15 minutes or something like that. We had time left over, but that was running 43-foot and not 36-foot, so. We can actually transport more grain, and the trailers themselves actually handle a lot better. It's a lot more axles on the ground, more braking power, distributes the weight a lot easier. So even with our T600, the T600 is able to handle that weight in game fairly well, and still be able to handle it at a pretty decent speed, 55 miles an hour. And I did a dry run with the CT660, and that just handles it like it's really nothing. And it's so well balanced, and if you put down the cheater axle, it handles really well. It's a little bit more difficult to steer, so you can always lift that cheater axle up when it's time to. Have to do something over in that little it in when I come back down. It's actually a big little hill. Way out here for you guys. Kind of in the middle of a foresty, kind of mountainy, different terrain down here next to the quarry and sandstone on the other side of these hills. So we were able to actually plant all of our land well within 2 days. We rented these DBD planters for 48 hours, and it's no issue whatsoever planting all of our ground. So we still have like 2.2 million in debt. So we're leasing a lot of land. We're renting a lot of equipment, such as planters, because we can't afford to buy it yet. So. And then this guy is close, you know, he's got an hour and a half left in. He's going to be traded in after we're done planting, that's for sure. So it'll be interesting to see how a sunflower harvest goes. Make sure I lower this planter down. So I don't know if you guys like John Deere or not. Me, really, I don't really care. I'm not really loyal to any brand. I just like building John Deere stuff because there's none of it out there. I'd like to use it. And I'd like to build a Kraus Dominator, but unfortunately, it's not very big. I mean, it's big. It's the biggest one they have is 21 foot, but I mean, I'm not gonna spend an enormous amount of time building a 21 foot chisel plow when you got Case IH that makes a 26 footer, and you got John Deere that makes a 26 footer, and a 27 footer. So unfortunately, like, people ask me about like Landall, Krauss and stuff like that. It's like, yeah, I'm totally open to building stuff. But unfortunately, it's too small for what I want to use on the server. Because, you know, we're eventually going to get up to, you know, 2,600 acres. And if you're trying to cultivate 2,600 acres with two 21-foot chisel plows, it's going to get boring really, really fast. So, I just can't justify making something that, you know, we just won't use. So. And of course, I mean, the 2730 by itself is, it's so unique. I don't want to say it's ugly, because, I mean, it is kind of ugly, but I just look at it, and it's just like a fortress of a chisel plow. Like, the thing, if you look at videos in it, or you see, like, people standing next to it, it is gigantic. It's so impressive, and, you know, at the end of the day, when I finish everything up, and I finish, you know, cussing and slamming my keyboard and stuff like that, and it's all in game and it works great, it's going to be well worth it, because I'll never use my 2720 again. I guarantee that once I get my 2730 in game. In fact, I might just delete 2720 because it's uploaded everywhere now once I released it. But, model on that's pretty out of date. It's the first model I ever built, so I have since improved dramatically. Same with texturing and scripting. But we're trading in our equipment after 100 hours, which, depending on what machine it is, you know, that could be anywhere from 3 seasons to, 3 to 5 season trade-in. Like, our combines, we have 2 of them. Can't believe I actually bought 2 combines, but I did. They don't get that many hours on them. They probably get 10 or 20 hours. What do? Our last harvest, we put like 20 hours on our grain cart tractor. So our combines get like 20 hours a season, which is nothing. So they can run for 5 seasons before we trade them in. Our big tillage tractors, they're running, they're planting. These tractors, the ATI was on the grain cart, that's why it has more hours than the row crop. But when we upgrade to a 700, it's going to be chisel plowing, it's going to be on grain carts, it's going to be running all season long, and so it's going to get some serious hours quick. So, and that's the way it should be when you're buying those big tractors. You buy them for efficiency, and when you have a 1500 bushel grain cart, you need a lot of horsepower to pull that thing around the field and catch up. So, next thing would be trading off the 990 row crop and getting another big bin extension, or who knows, maybe a John Deere or maybe a Lexion. Who really knows? So we burnt up about 12,000 liters of seed in this field so far. Like to harvest all those trees and extend this field a little bit more, try to stretch out, you know, maybe another 5-10 acres or so, whatever that ends up being. Help the bottom line, cost nothing except time to go plow that up, get money from harvesting the trees, have to go get a stump grinder. Our last pass. So hopefully next time we get planting, we'll have a DB120 on the server. That'd be nice. I'm sure you guys would appreciate that. Seeing that massive piece of machinery back on the server. Haven't actually used it on the server yet, so I guess I can't say it's back on the server. Anyways, we'll fold up our planter here. Show up anyways. Here is the bank, and you can see all the yellow are our lease. Yep, green we own, yellow we're leasing. So you can see a majority of our fields we're leasing a lot of our acreage. So but these are the fields I want to pick up next season. 35, 36, 16, 9, and 8. But before we can do that, we're gonna have to purchase another bin site. Yeah. Not exactly sure. We have this big one here, which is like $500,000 or $600,000. We have a site here, which is like $250,000 or $300,000 or something like that. Then there's one over here that we could buy, and then obviously we could buy this farm, That's insanely. It's like 1.8 million for like 30,000 bushels. It's actually thinking of adding like some bins right here or something, so we can like drive an auger over and unload. spins over here would probably be good. Bin facilities like over here. I don't know. Maybe over here. Maybe probably right here would be a good location. Anyway, as you can see, our lease rates. So field 44. Actually, we'll go with like a field. Go with field 19. If we bring up our calculator here, we're at 1321, and then we go to this, we're looking at 119 divided by 119. Forget what it was. I think it's like $277 an acre to rent that. That seems about right. Because our grow season is 5 stages at 5 days. So that's what that comes out to be. That's our lease rate, which is pretty reasonable for 19. Some of the fields are, I think this is the most expensive. Most of them are probably around 220 or 240 around there. Anyways, I can officially mark that off. Save it. Guys, so I'm gonna call it a day. Thanks for stopping by and watching. Pan out here. Oh, you can see the train coming by again, doing its crazy curve. That's also where Jake drove off the map. Shocking, I know. Anyways, that train goes all the way back there, so you can't see it, then goes all the way around this big corner and then goes all the way over there and then does another kind of horseshoe loop. See Semstone in the quarry and that field, what is that? Is that field 23? 22. That looks like an incredible field. I remember planting sugar beets there. That was going to be a nice field, so. There's our 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 fields left to go, guys. 25, 26, 27, 28, 24 is sunflower. And then this whole little middle section here is all soybeans. So, thanks for watching.